Welcome to TCM, everybody. I'm Ben Mankiewicz. Tonight, our spotlight on World War II films continues from the National World War II Museum here in New Orleans. The spotlight is meant to commemorate the 75th anniversary of the D-Day invasion, June 6th, 1944. I am joined by Gregory Cooke. Gregory, thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Gregory is a teacher at Drexel University, but you've also written extensively about World War II. How did that interest in World War II take shape for you?
About 31 years or so ago, I had what I like to tell people is like I was spiritually compelled to go to Belgium. It was like an itch I couldn't get rid of. And so finally I went to Bastogne, which was the focal point of the Battle of the Bulge.
Yeah.
I walked into the Martisan Museum in Bastogne, and there I saw black soldiers in World War II for the first time in my life. And that set off a lot of research on my part, a lot of curiosity. And that started all the other work that I've been doing about World War II and African America.
So you, a grown man at that point, and you had never seen black soldiers in uniform from World War II.
Yes.
Clearly that made an impact because it has become, to some extent, part of your life's work.
Yes, it is part of my life work now. And when I realized that more than a million African Americans, men and women, served in the military in World War II, and I knew nothing about that, I had to make the assumption a whole lot of other people didn't know either. And I saw that as a great omission that I could help remedy, take care of, because World War II, in my opinion, was the most consequential event in human history. And African Americans played a critical role in that.
You've made a couple of documentaries, one you're working on now,
yes.
Correct? From 2009, Chocolate Soldiers from the USA. That
yes.
was about 140,000 black soldiers were stationed in Great Britain during
yes.
the war, is that right?
Yes. Prior to D-Day, there were about 140,000 African-American soldiers in Great Britain. And that was a very interesting experience for them, because for the first time, they were treated as Americans by the Brits. The British people did not have any established racial color bar or Jim Crow or anything like that. And so when these men and women went to Great Britain, they were treated first as Americans, as people coming to help in the war, and they were treated as human beings. Now, that got a little dicey because of politics, I guess. Racial lines were crossed. You had interracial dating, particularly with African-American men and British civilians. And so part of the U.S. Army response to that was to implement Jim Crow in Great Britain.
So the movie we have tonight up first, Best Years of Our Lives, wonderful picture, deals with three servicemen, three veterans coming home after the war. I imagine it was a very different experience for African Americans coming home.
Yes, it was. For the most part, African Americans came home to the back of the bus. They came home, they were not able to vote, particularly in the South. One of the most consequential African Americans of World War II that very few people know about, his name was Isaac Woodard. Yeah. He was a decorated soldier. He'd been discharged from the Army for 3 hours. He was on a bus. He had a verbal altercation with the bus driver, and he was taken off the bus, and he was beaten, and his eyes were gouged out. And eventually news of this got to President Truman, and Truman was outraged. And as a result of that, what he saw and what he learned about that incident, he became very aggressive in terms of talking about the social ills regarding race in America and started proposing legislation and fixes in terms of the racial problems in this country.
So the Isaac Woodard case, the impetus in many ways for the desegregation of the United States Armed Services.
Yes, there was another factor also that factored in. During World War II, during the Battle of the Bulge, on Christmas Day, Eisenhower wrote a letter to African American troops saying that we will give you the privilege of fighting alongside your white comrades. However, there was a catch. You had to take a pay reduction and a reduction in rank. So if you were an African-American sergeant, you had to give up your rank and pay to join these units, because the Army did not want a black sergeant commanding white privates. So what was interesting about those 2,221 African-Americans who volunteered...
2,221 African-American servicemen took that deal.
Yes.
Lost pay, lost
yes.
rank.
Yes.
For the privilege of joining the fight against the Germans.
Yes. Many of them felt like they had something to prove as men, as Americans. And so they went on to join some of the Army's most storied units. Now, this was by the time they were fully trained, we're talking late January of 45, so the war was almost over. But in about the 2 months of combat that they experienced, you got two Medal of Honor winners from that group. And that was one of the factors that factored into Truman desegregating the military, because the after-action reports were very positive about how black men handled themselves in combat.
Gregory, thanks very much.
Thank you.
We'll take a look at Best Years of Our Lives now. We'll talk more about it after we see it. From 1946, directed by William Wyler, the Best Picture Oscar winner of 1946, The Best Years of Our Lives. Welcome back to the National World War II Museum in New Orleans. I'm with Gregory Cooke. He's an instructor at Drexel University. He's also made a couple of documentaries, one you're working on right now, Invisible Warriors, African-American Women in World War II. So there's a moment in the movie, and it's a very touching moment, when Frederick March has returned to work at the bank, and a prospective client comes in seeking a loan, and he has no collateral, and it's clear that that loan should be rejected. But because he's a veteran, that Al's character is a wonderfully decent, kind, empathetic person, he goes ahead and approves the loan.
And now you want to buy a farm?
Yes, sir. Got my eye on a fine piece of property. 40 acres out near Anton Corners.
What about collateral?
Had that veteran been African-American, unless it's a bizarre set of circumstances, that loan does not get approved.
Right, that's not going to happen. And the GI Bill had two major parts to it. One was free education at a college, university, trade school, what have you. And the other part was a low interest mortgage, right, which was a primary driver for wealth building after the war. Well, African Americans, service people, were able to get the part of the GI Bill that allowed them to go to school, although most schools in America did not allow them in because of race, but they were able to go to HBCUs, historically black colleges and universities. So that part worked for them. However, the part of the low mortgages, the inexpensive low mortgages for black people, most were not able to qualify that because of redlining and racial discrimination. And what was also very profound about that, the man had no collateral.
Right, yeah.
None.
So, yeah.
And something about his character I thought was interesting too, because he describes himself as a farmer before the war, and now he has his eye on a piece of land on 40 acres.
Yeah.
And the whole 40 acres and a mule thing, right, you know, harkens back to the Civil War in terms of what black people, newly freed slaves, were promised after the war. And he also says, I was a sharecropper before the war, like my father before me. Now, the average white male going into the service World War II was not a sharecropper. However, for many of the black men, who particularly those who came from the South, that's exactly what they were.
If that character had been black, it wouldn't have had to change anything about his story. Nothing. Wouldn't
right.
have had to change a word of his lines, anything.
Exactly.
It's almost like the intent was to make that character black, except that character couldn't be black
right.
without raising
right.
some objections.
All right.
Gregory, this has been great, great stuff, a totally different way to look at these films, so thanks
Thank
very much.
Thank you.
Don't go away. Gregory and I will return momentarily with a Preston Sturges film from 1944, Hail the Conquering Hero. Welcome to Turner Classic Movies, everybody. I'm Ben Mankiewicz. We're in the midst of our two-month-long spotlight every Thursday night throughout May and June, featuring World War II movies, all done to commemorate the 75th anniversary of the D-Day invasion, June 6th, 1944. I'm joined by Gregory Cooke. Gregory, thanks for being
Thank
here
you.
Once again. Gregory is an instructor at Drexel University. He's been studying World War II, interviewing veterans for 32 years. as a documentary from 2009 called Chocolate Soldiers from the USA about the 140,000 black troops in Great Britain during the war, and currently at work on Invisible Warriors, African American women in World War II. The movie we have coming up now is Hail the Conquering Hero, Preston Sturges' film from 1944. It's a wonderful film, but we're going to focus our conversation on an idea that a big idea the movie raises, which is that we deify things in this country and don't look at the real problems that we have. The war forced us to look at some very real problems as we put 16 million people in uniform. So the war presented an opportunity for civil rights organizers in the United States, didn't it?
Yes.
How so?
Leading up to World War II, African Americans in large parts of the country, particularly in the South, but not exclusively in the South, were economic, politically, socially disenfranchised. And so going into the war, this whole question of our civil rights, black people's civil rights, and how were black people going to respond to the war? Black people have fought in every war this country's ever had, and in some cases have fought with distinction. But going into World War II, there were a lot of social problems here. And so one of the things that happened shortly after the war started, we're talking January, February 1942, the Pittsburgh Courier newspaper, which was one of the leading African-American newspapers of the day, began a program called the Double V campaign. And the Double V stood for victory over fascism overseas and victory over racism at home. And so it was something that African Americans rallied around throughout the war.
Hail the Conquering Hero, which focuses on hero worship because you have a guy who couldn't serve and thinks that's everything, right?
Right.
And obviously it's a biting, wonderful satire as only Preston Sturges could make. But of course there were thousands of ways to serve for people who were either too old to serve or in Eddie Bracken's case in the movie, not qualified to serve.
Right. So, you know, activities on the home front involved a lot more than just the Rosie the Riveters working in factories. Women, African-American women, all women, they did things like they ran USO shows, they conducted blood drives, bond drives. So American women were integrally involved in helping America win the war and holding down things on the home front. They were heroes too. It's just that they've never, in my opinion, gotten their just due for the work that they did. And after all, had they not done the work they did, both in the factories and other activities on the home front, it would have been very, very difficult to win the war.
Your current documentary, Invisible Warriors, African American Women in World War II, how many African American women were involved in the war effort?
In terms of the home front, there were at least 600,000 African American Rosie the Riveters.
And your mom being one of them?
Yes, my mother being one of them. And when I was a kid, she used to tell me this story about how she rode on her suitcase from Norfolk, Virginia to Washington, D.C. during the war. She never elaborated, but I do remember when she talked about it, her whole mood and attitude kind of picked up. She seemed to have a certain sense that she had done something really big. And I've talked to a number of these women who worked in shipyards, who built airplanes. One woman, Ruth Wilson, who helped build an aircraft carrier, the USS Valley Forge at the Philadelphia Navy Yard, she told me it made her feel like she had done something big. And so it's unfortunate, I think, that they have not gotten their just due for the roles that they serve during the war.
Well, that's why you're here, Gregory. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Here's the movie from 1944. This is Preston Sturges' eighth and final movie for Paramount, Hail the Conquering Hero. I am back here with Gregory Cooke at the National World War II Museum in New Orleans, part of our spotlight on World War II films throughout May and June. 75 movies to commemorate the 75th anniversary of the D-Day invasion. Gregory, you've made a couple of documentaries. One you're working on now, Invisible Warriors, African American Women in World War II. The other from 2009, Chocolate Soldiers from the USA, about black troops in Great Britain. Obviously, black soldiers who served affected by the same psychological trauma that affected every other soldier, PTSD, battle fatigue then. number of the films in the spotlight have highlighted the effects on the home front, particularly in Great Britain, cities and towns bombed on a regular basis. PTSD didn't affect merely soldiers.
Yes, I think PTSD seemed to affect anybody who was in a combat zone. So Mrs. Ruth Wilson, one of the Rosies who's in Invisible Warriors, African-American women in World War II, her husband served in Europe. And he didn't talk a lot about it, but from what she could gather, he was in Graves registration. And that had a profound impact on him. When he came home, she really didn't know the man who had left. She also told me whenever he would hear an airplane flying over, he would dive under the bed. Now, he was not a combat soldier, right, but he was still obviously affected by the horrors of war. And so I think too often we think of PTSD, then battle fatigue, as something that affects only combat troops. I think it is much broader reaching than that.
So Graves registration is literally the registering of graves.
Yes.
What was that job?
Well, basically, you would go around the battlefield and pick up the bodies of dead soldiers, identify them. Soldiers had two dog tags, and one would stay with the body, and one was, you know, given to authorities to indicate that person had been killed.
And frequently, that was the notification. That was,
yes,
to find out how to notify the next of kin.
Yes, and that was one of the jobs that African-American soldiers did, because for the most part, they were not involved in combat.
Oh, there's no question that on a regular basis, walking around a battlefield afterwards and identifying the dead, that there is a particular kind of trauma,
yes,
that comes with that. Right, I'm wearing my father's dog tags right now, and the thing that gets me every time is that they're really death tags.
Yeah.
And so you're walking around with a notification of how people handle it if you're killed.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, again, but part of the immersive experience you get here is you learn if you visit this museum, and I recommend everybody to come to this museum, and when they do, be prepared to spend more than one day. It's a totally immersive experience. It touches you in ways you do not expect. This war is so much bigger than the battles that we all know about, and
yes,
and the effects of the war were felt by so many more people than merely the soldiers overseas fighting in the Pacific and the European theater operations.
Absolutely.
Gregory, interesting stuff. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Stay with us. Coming up next from 1946, Edward Dimitrik's Till the End of Time. Hello and welcome to Turner Classic Movies. I'm Ben Mankiewicz, coming to you from the National World War II Museum in New Orleans, part of our two-month-long spotlight throughout May and June of World War II films to commemorate the 75th anniversary of the D-Day invasion, June 6th, 1944. I am joined by Gregory Cooke once again. Gregory, thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Gregory's an instructor at Drexel University. He's also produced a couple of documentaries, one he's working on right now, Invisible Warriors, African-American Women in World War II. The movie we have coming up now from 1946 till the end of time suffers, I think, from being released in 1946. This is directed by Edward Dimitrik, produced by Dori Sherry. It's a big production, but it is the story of three Marines coming home and experiencing life at home after the war, readjusting to civilian life. When you talk movies about readjusting to civilian life from 1946, there is the best years of our lives, and essentially there is nothing else. Although, this movie actually came out before Best Years of Our Life. But in hindsight, though it's a quality film, it is not the best years of our life. So, it's an interesting story. Again, unlike Best Years, they are all from the same branch of the service. These are three Marines coming home. The experience that these Marines have back at home, readjusting, like in Best Years, is a challenging one. Here, typically of a Hollywood production in the mid-40s, these soldiers are all white, but there were hundreds of thousands of black troops coming home and adjusting themselves. How was their experience, Gregory, different?
The big things that made the African-American soldiers' homecoming different is the fact that you just fought in the Pacific, you just fought in Europe, and you're coming home to the back of the bus, you're coming home and you're unable to vote. And so for them, the fight continued. There was also a great deal of racial violence in America during the war and right after the war in particular. And often African-American men were murdered while still in uniform because they chose to challenge traditional laws and customs like Jim Crow and segregation.
There's also the circumstance of black troops simply not being believed that they had participated in the war. And in your 2009 documentary, Chocolate Soldiers in the USA, you talked to a veteran who was at D-Day and nobody bought his story.
Right. On D-Day, there were approximately 2,500 African-Americans who landed on Omaha and Utah beaches. Omaha was the most violent of the landings. And this individual's name was William Dabney. He was with the 320th Anti-Aircraft Barrage Balloon Battalion. He came ashore on D-Day. He came ashore in the first waves. And he told me about how the blood was running red on the beach. And, you know, he did live through the war. As when he came home and he told people in his community that he was in D-Day, no one believed him.
So even inside the African-American community, people didn't believe him?
Yes, because D-Day is one of the significant days in Western history, Western culture. And for the most part, African-Americans have been kind of edited out of that. So that was reasonable for people to assume because you just did not see African-American soldiers in such, you know, critical and pivotal moments in the war.
Yeah, there's an image of D-Day and there's a face that we associate with
yes.
D-Day, and it's
yes.
a grizzled, unshaven,
yes.
dirty white soldier, a hero.
And black folks were not heroes in World War II, at least the official line was. There was a lot of effort to make sure that black Americans were portrayed in a certain way during the war. And remember, during the war, if you wanted to get news or pictures of the war, you went to the movies.
Right.
Right? And so there were separate, there were different newsreels for black theaters and different newsreels for white theaters. But often in black theaters, you would also still see white newsreels. And so overwhelmingly, a lot of the images you saw of combat, of heroes, of sacrifice, et cetera, were of white soldiers.
And now in 2019, we have come to recognize the value of seeing someone like you on the screen. It's taken at face value for people like me because I've seen people who look like me my entire
okay.
life on the screen.
Yes. You know, one of the things I like to do is to bring attention to the sacrifices of 1.1 million African Americans who served in the military during the war. And they were limited, not because that was their choice. They were limited by the federal government, by the War Department. There was a policy in the War Department that only 9% of the military could be black. And that was based upon the idea that 9% of the American population was black, and so they weren't going to exceed that. And there was this general feeling that the war and the military is not a time and a place for social experiments.
We hear that argument now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Gregory, well, we've brought you here to shed light on this, so
thank you
for doing it. I appreciate it. Here's the film from 1946, directed by Edward Dimitrik, Till the End of Time. I'm back here at the National World War II Museum in New Orleans. My guest tonight has been Gregory Cooke. Gregory, thanks for sharing your insights
you.
On these three films and the circumstances of the war and post-war for African-American men and women in the United States. So there's a fight at the end of the movie when the Marines are confronted by these, I don't know whether you wouldn't really call them America Firsters, because they already lost that argument, the war is over, but by what seems to be sort of maybe a precursor to the John Birch Society. This, and the guy says, hey, you should come join our organization. No blacks, no Jews, no Catholics. You'll love it.
Right.
Right. And that starts a fight. But there's a black soldier in that scene, and you had an interesting interpretation of it that I suspect most people wouldn't have had.
Well, I thought what was interesting about that, Robert Mitchum, his character, took offense to that. But in pushing back against this individual who said no blacks, no Jews, no Catholics, he referenced a Jewish guy who was in his unit who had been killed, I think, on Guadalcanal.
Right.
And what was interesting, the black soldier was standing right there, and the black soldier looks at him, and he then kind of moves away when he hears what's going on. And I thought it was just kind of interesting that the fight was not about the African-American soldier who was actually right there. And I don't know if that had something to do with the fact that the military was segregated in World War II, so you wouldn't have had that, you wouldn't have had a lot of common action or interaction between black and white soldiers during the war. You would have Jewish soldiers, you know, integrated into the white units. But I just found it a bit problematic because the African-American soldier was right there, but it was almost like he wasn't there, you know? And it was almost like he was inconsequential.
Right. It's a revealing moment of where we were in 1946.
Yes.
I presume, partly because of your work, but we are in a better place now of acknowledging the contributions of African-American men and women, both in uniform and as Rosie the Riveters, like your mom.
Yes. First of all, I'd like to say, I don't think Rosies, white, black, Latina, have ever gotten their just due for their contributions to the war. And I think from my own experience of talking to the Rosies, what's interesting about them is none of them understood the historical significance. They saw themselves as having a job and a better economic opportunity. Right after the war, most of those women went back to domestic service. Remember, more than 80% of all black women before the war were either sharecroppers or domestic servants. Right after the war, a lot of those women had to return to those jobs, but starting in 1940 into the early 1960s, domestic service among African Americans steadily declined. To the point today, I'm guessing black women who do that kind of work are probably statistically very, very small.
So Gregory, the film you're working on now, Invisible Warriors, African-American Women in World War II, where can people find out more information about that?
They can go to www.invisiblewarriorsfilm.com, and there they can see a trailer, they can see the scholars and the Rosies who are participants. My email address, et cetera, that information is there if they would like to get in touch.
Gregory, this has been an honor. Thanks for sharing your insights.
You.
We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Don't go away. Our spotlight on World War II films continues next with John Garfield and Eleanor Parker in Pride of the Marines.